Welcome to the Getty Centre. My name is Susan McDonald, and I'm the head of field projects at the Getty Conservation Institute, and I'm also the project director of the Conserving Modern Architecture Initiative. In keeping with our mission at the Conservation Institute, or the GCI, of advancing conservation practice, our work in the Conserving Modern Architecture Initiative aims to follow this mission within the realm of 20th century heritage broadly and modern architecture more specifically. And as part of this initiative, we've been very pleased to present a series of public lectures and events. And tonight is the third of these public events and the second of our panels. Our first panel discussion involved three architects from the US, two from Los Angeles and one from Chicago, and explored some of the ideas that individual practitioners are facing and some of the challenges that they're experiencing conserving the architecture of the modern era. Tonight, our discussion moves across the seas, and we are going to have a look at what's happening in other parts of the world, and we're really pleased to have three colleagues with us who are engaged in organisations that are dedicated to dealing with the challenges of conserving a modern heritage. Our format tonight is a panel discussion, I'm going to introduce them in a moment and invite them to join me here on the stage. After we've been talking for about an hour, we will invite the audience to join in, to ask questions, to have comments, to generally to join in our discussion. So we're really keen that you have an opportunity to do that. So keep your questions and please join in. With our panelists tonight, we're going to explore what catalyzed their different organizations, what issues have been important in the areas of the world that they're working, and what progress has been made in this endeavour. We'll also discuss whether the issues are global or local or regional, and how this might impact how we can advance practice, and what are the things that we need to do, and what level do we need to be working at. I've been asked to remind you that photographs and video recording of the event are not permitted. We will be videoing this evening's event, and that will be up on our website within the next few weeks. So without further ado, I would like to ask our panellists to join me. Come and take a seat, and I will introduce you. So on my far left, on your right, is Catherine Croft, a writer, journalist and preservationist. Catherine is the director of the 20th Century Society in London, which is a UK-based non-profit dedicated to safeguarding the heritage of architecture and design in Britain from 1914 onwards. And the Society's prime objectives are conservation and education. In our centre is Professor Johannes Widodo, who is the co-director of the Tun Tan Chung Lok Centre for Asian Architectural and Urban Heritage at the National University of Singapore. Johannes is a member of the Modern Architecture Asian Architecture Network, or MAN. We talked about whether I pronounced that correctly earlier, and evidently there are lots of different iterations. And that's a network that spans the vast and varied continent of Asia, and so is working at a regional level. And closest to me is Hubert-Jan Henket, who is an architect who has been working in private practice. He's an emeritus professor at the University of Delft. And Hubert-Jan is one of the co-founders of DOCOMOMO International, an organisation that now has over 60 member countries. And really the organisation that's been working at an international level to catalyse action, to advance practice and scholarship in this area. And Hubert-Jan was awarded the second World Monuments Fund Knoll Prize for Modernism for his work in conserving Zonnestal Sanatorium in 2010, the second of the three awards for that, three iterations of that award. We realised that this afternoon that we are actually all members of DOCOMOMO International. I think we have 6 different countries and memberships represented around between the four of us. So that was just something that indicates perhaps how people are working internationally and people's interests and how far the reach is has been so far. So please join me in welcoming our panellists this evening.
So,
to kick off our discussion this evening, we wanted to talk a little bit about how each of you is involved in organisations dedicated to conserving modern heritage generally and architecture more specifically. And so I'm going to ask our panelists if they can tell us briefly how and why their respective organisations were formed. Was there a particular event that catalysed this establishment of their organisation, and what sort of issues their organisations are trying to address, who the audience is, and the type of heritage places that they are engaged with. And Catherine, as the 20th Century Society is perhaps the oldest organisation represented here, perhaps you might like to start.
Yes, I'm not used to being representing the oldest organisation anyway. We were initially founded as the 30th Society in 1979, and I'm showing these two images because the case that really galvanised people to form the Society was the proposal to demolish the Lloyd's Building by Edwin Cooper, which was a classical revival building of the 1920s. And in fact, just as a sort of indication of how far we've kind of evolved and moved, one of our campaigns last year was to get the building the eventual solution, the Richard Rogers building for the new Lloyd's building, incorporates just a small fragment of the Edwin Cooper building. But we were instrumental in getting the replacement building listed last year, which obviously was quite a big step for some of my trustees who'd been involved from the very beginning. I think we've always struggled with our name, and I'm constantly asked now when we're going to rename ourselves as, you know, the 21st Century Society. But from the beginning, I think we were interested obviously buildings from the 20s as well as the 30s, but really that whole period up from 1914 up until the Second World War, from 1914 onwards, because buildings of the Edwardian period are dealt with by a separate society called the Victorian Society. So, and I think the one thing that kind of distinguishes what we've been doing from a lot of other organisations is that we're interested in all styles of building and all building types. And actually quite a lot of the early casework was around Art Deco buildings. Some of the early members, I think, were particularly interested in Deco and traditional revival buildings. And a lot of our members at the beginning were enthusiasts and architectural historians as opposed to architects. I think that was the constituency we were reaching out to. So we're a non-profit, a charity, and we are largely funded through individual members, for whom, so they pay subscriptions, and we organise trips and make a profit on the trips, and we then also have a very small central government grant, and we have a role in the planning process in Britain, in that any local authority that has an application to demolish a listed building has to consult us about it. Should we look at the next one? Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I mean we take the define building very broadly. We had a big campaign early on for phone boxes, and just because of the way the legislation is framed in the UK, we argued that these could be listed as buildings, and a lot of them are now listed as little individual listed buildings. And we've recently moved on to a campaign for the what's known as the K8 phone box, which is the one on the bottom left, which the traditional ones that you see on all the picture postcards are by the architect Giles Gilbert Scott, who did the Battersea Power Station, and the K8 was designed by a guy called Bruce Martin, who was responsible for the Hertfordshire Schools Programme, which was a way of doing systemized mass production of school buildings after the war, and he applied the same logic to the phone box. So, and that was our kind of first venture into marketing. We had tea towels with the phone box on it as an attempt to broaden the constituency that we were talking to. We've worked with the World Monument Fund. We've been really grateful to them for their support and for putting British brutalism on the watch list for 2012, which has been, I think, very good for drawing attention to the fact that a lot of the key brutalist buildings in the UK aren't listed. We are now moving on, I think, to look at buildings of later decades of the 70s and 80s as well.
Okay. Great. Johannes, would you like to tell us something about Man?
Yeah. Actually, there are some issues in the around the year 2000s that trigger the formation of this network. The first one actually is happening in South Korea, in Seoul, which is the demolitions of the National Museum buildings, which used to be built by the Japanese as the center of governments in Seoul, as taken as a symbol of colonialism. And a few years before, that building was being demolished. And the second reason is, of course, is the when we reflect on why we demolishing this building. Is it because it's representing a certain ideology, or is it something to do with something else? How to value these buildings? And then we found out there is no literature, there is no guidelines at all. So we found out that DOCOMOMO at that time just published a kind of list on or a formula of how to conduct an inventory of a modernist buildings. We found out that actually not a single buildings in Asia will qualify as a MOMO. None. Because we are hybrid, we are so layered, and we are so mixed. So our shop houses, for example, in Singapore, in Malaysia, or Indonesia, doesn't qualify for that. Our colonial buildings, or hybrid architecture, like Chiang Kai-shek monuments, or Great Hall of the Peoples in Beijing, will be fit into that categories. So we think, well, maybe we need to have something else. So we are, instead of focusing on the big M, we are deciding to look more closely into the small M. Because there's a lot of issues in ideology. What is modernism? What is modernity? So for us, we found out that actually modernism in Asia is more like a process rather than a product. Okay, and then it was in Canton, maybe the next slide. And we are thinking of what kind of organizations that we structure of organizations. We don't like structure that is like e-commerce. E-commerce is very strict and very practical kind of things. We don't like something like UNESCO, because it's also very state top-down. We don't like something like DOCOMOMO, because it's very academic. And so we decided to form organizations look like a Chinese dining table. That you have a round table that everybody can eat and take whatever they like. They can come and go whatever they like. It's like a food court. So the concept of food court is the beginning of the thinking that, well, we should embrace internet as a means of communications, the cheapest, and we decided to use broken English as an official language. And for every conferences, we let everyone speak of their own languages, and we use foreign students who can speak two or three languages, the bilingual, like Japanese, who can speak Chinese, and so on, to sit in a crowd among the participants to translate. It costs no money because you don't need to pay for the interpreter professionals. And it works. And so far, we have organized around, it's already 12 years old organizations. And we have connections with DOCOMOMO International. Maristella Cassiato is our good friend with the 20th Century e-commerce. Sheridan from Australia, even UNESCO World Heritage and local initiatives and so on. So we form this kind of core, executive core. So everyone can become an executive. Mm-hmm. Everyone can use the logo freely, and everyone can download everything from the sites freely. Mm-hmm. So next one, I think, is... Yeah, and this is the objective, actually. The first thing that's very important for us in Asia is to shift paradigms. All the books like Bannister Fletcher is still widely used as a textbook in the schools in Asia. So we want to grow another trees, not like Bannister Fletcher's trees, because our architecture is very different. It's hybrid and layered. So to shift these paradigms from Asian modernization process to Asian modernity and Asian identity. The second is to bridge differences like Asia and the rest of the world, languages, approaches, paradigms, to create synergy between academic, professional, and policymakers, and to influence curriculum. So since the very beginning, we pay a lot of attention to students and even children. Well, we always say to them that we will retire very soon. So this global warming, carbon footprint, sustainability is your problem, not our problems. We just want to enjoy our lives. So in order to survive for yourself and your descendants, you have to act. So since 4 years ago, all programs by this network is run by people under 40 years old. And they use whatever means, like video clips as a form of paper presented in the seminar. It's not on very academic papers like what we know. And we organize a kids program for children during the summer holidays and so on. Because at the end of the day, the most important missions is to empower the community and the younger generations. The empowerment, because the main issues is not focusing too much on the physical conservations, but how to preserve the habitat which generates the architecture. So modernity, modernism, is become always relevant from the past to the present. And we talk about the timeline. We are not just engaging pre-war, post-war modernism, but we are trying to expand, if possible, as far as since the creation of the Silk Road, which connect Europe and Asia as the beginning of modernity or modernity process, and goes as far as today. So I think that will be, I think, a starting point of of all this discourse in the Asian architecture.
Great. Thank you. Hubert-Jan?
Yes.
How about DOCOMOMO? You want?
It's interesting. I try to avoid starting the debate already because modernity, here you see it. The interesting thing of modernity is that it's basically the idea that you want to get independence of every individual through the progress of science and technology, which, at least in our part of the world, didn't start with the Silk Road. It started about in the Renaissance, and then from there on, the Enlightenment, the Industrial Revolution, etc. And I think the modern project is still going on. It's an ongoing process. That's one. So it's a process, not a product. It's not a style, it's a way of thinking. And there you see it as a symbol. It's the red and blue chair by Rietveld. In our country, we have a lot of icons of the modern movement. Famous ones, the Fanella Factory, Wessel de Jonge talked about it a few months ago, a week ago here, the Rietveld-Schroeder House, Zonnestraal, etc. And the Dutch government in the early 80s didn't know what to do with these buildings because we had so many and they were all in a very bad state because they were all designed not for eternity but for temporality, for a short time. And they asked me what to do, and I, together with my colleague Wessel de Jonge, who was then my assistant at the university, we did this study, and then after we finished it, after 5 years, we thought it might be interesting to talk to other people as well, because it was an interesting subject, because in fact what you're doing with conservation, and we talk about that later, conservation of modernity, of the modern movement, is a paradox in itself, because you talk about, next slide please, you talk about throwaway buildings which you want to keep for eternity, And I think that is a fantastic philosophical paradox, and that's what we have to solve. And that's, I think, what we are talking about tonight. So anyway, we try to do two things. One is to have a debate about this peculiar paradox, and the other one was to try to get international attention to this particular building, to Sanatorium Sonnenstrahl in Hilversum, because it's, I'll show you at the end of my talk the end result, and it's such a beautiful and inspiring building that obviously we try to do that. Anyway, I had a few friends in other countries, so I approached them and I said, would you like to join into the debate? And yes, there were about five or six countries who wanted to join, and we had to figure out a name. And I thought, you know, we have to have something peculiar as a name because it's got to stick. So I thought DOCOMOMO was something very interesting because that was documentation and conservation of buildings and sites of the modern movement, DOCOMOMO. And a friend of mine in England, Christopher Dean, when I proposed the name, he said, that's such a beautiful Swahili name, do it. So then we started. Our first conference, we had 13 countries there to join into the idea. We founded DOCOMOMO, we made a constitution, and ever since, we are now in 63 countries. It's a vast network of people who all have different approaches towards modernity, as you can hear, and I'm extremely glad to see that everybody's a member of DOCOMOMO. Because in 1988, we didn't
wasn't
think...
wasn't a prerequisite.
this would ever going to happen. In fact, it was our intention not to be big, because we wanted to keep the way of thinking and you know, the debate between people as close to our chest as possible, because we wanted to stay an organization of friends. And it's still that type of organization, but we are very worried about the fact that we don't get too big, because, you know, it gets more bureaucratic, and therefore you lose a lot of the basic ideas which you originally wanted to solve. Our next conference will be in Asia, in Seoul, in 2014, which for us will be an enormous trigger to move to the next phase, because as you heard already from Johannes, the way of thinking about modernity in Asia is totally different.
Great, thank you. So DOCOMOMO is an international organization, as Hubert-Jan just said, over 60 countries. MAN is a regional network, although, you know, I think there's a lot of differences between the countries, like any region. It's not homogenous by any means. And Catherine, you're working in a national context. So we wanted to talk a little bit more about what you think that the issues might be around the conservation of modern architecture, and whether they are, any of them are truly universal or global. Do you think there's big regional cultural differences? And we already have explored that a little bit, in fact. What are those big differences? Do some of them present barriers for how we might move forward when we were trying to approach the conservation of the 20th century? And are there barriers just to achieving recognition at a World Heritage level or even at a local level, and in terms of how we might be able to advance practice in this area? And we might just go in reverse order this time. I can watch you.
Well, yeah, I forgot this, yes. Yes, it is, the idea about modernity is very diverse. It depends very much on, you know, the social context in your country, the geographical context, all the, you know, all the differences which make us different anyway, create a different idea about modernity. And so therefore the approach towards modernity is different, and thus the idea of conservation will be different. So then you begin to wonder, what is the difference between conservation of modernity anyway towards traditional conservation? Well, I think if you think about the idea of modernity, that it is to get progress through the through science and technology, the idea of progress is that you don't be static any longer, you are dynamic. And you can see that not only did we get a completely different time concept as from the 18th century onward. First, we had a sort of cyclical way of thinking. Now we have a linear way of thinking. There are all reasons why that is. But we, you know, change and dynamics is basically one of the things of modernity. That means that if you want to solve the idea of change and temporality, you come to the idea of the modernity, which is the constant new. And that fits in with the market economy. The market economy forces you continuously to have something new, because otherwise you don't sell. And it's not only in the market economy, but in our philosophy as well, everything has to be inventive. So therefore, we said, and now this is an answer to Johannes, in DOCOMOMO, because we only concentrate on the modern movement, we don't concentrate like Catherine to all the things, but only to the modern movement. We said, if you want to have three criteria why buildings or sites or neighborhoods belong to the modern movement, they should be innovative in a social way, in a technical way, and or in an aesthetic way. And obviously the word social is first, because we think that the modern movement, modernity, is not a style, it's a way of thinking. It's progress, it's trying to elevate people to a better level. Therefore, we always gear to the future. Now, if you take temporality and the constant new as the basis of these buildings, then obviously the questions in conservation become very complex as well. The first thing you have to ask yourself is, what are we going to do? Are we going to protect all the historic layers within a building, or are you going to go back to the original? As you can see on these two pictures, this is Sanatorium Zonnestraal in Hilversum. You see it as the original one, and the picture on the right-hand side is after 30 years. So it's completely changed, and basically the original idea has completely gone on the right-hand side picture. So the first thing you have to wonder is, what are all these layers afterwards are adding to the importance of the building? With particular iconic buildings, I think it is basically the original idea which is the most important. The second question you then have to ask yourself, if you go back to the original, not only what is the original, but also what is left of that original. In most buildings which are industrially constructed out of industrial products, the products are not on the market any longer. So these buildings are not handcrafted, they are industrially produced, so therefore where are the products which you used before? Secondly, because of the temporality, a lot of these building components have only been, the intention was only to keep them for a few years, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, but not for eternity like traditional buildings. The next question is, if you can't get the original products any longer, if they are deteriorated to such an extent that you can't use them any longer, you move to reconstruction. Now, reconstruction and the traditional conservation mentality are at loggerheads. You should always go to the original material. And if we can't keep them any longer, because if you remember the picture before of Sonnestraal, it's just nothing is there any longer. The next one is, back. Modernity. is also complex as far as change is concerned, because most of these buildings, and it's still going on, are not designed for change. Traditional buildings were very often designed for change because they had they were over-dimensioned. In modern buildings, very often they are not over-dimensioned purely because of economic reasons. And so if you want to add new requirements, because in our societies, all the levels of requirements have only gone up. They've never gone down. They always go up. Mm. Your heating requirements, etc. And one of the main problems with these modern buildings is that the dimensions are such that it's very difficult to add new requirements because you need new layers, more space, etc. So that is, again, is one of the main problems of modern buildings as compared to traditional buildings, which are difficult to solve. Most of them are not neutrally designed as traditional buildings were. They are purposely designed, so they're much more like a glove to fit a particular function at that particular moment. Again, for economic reasons, because you don't know what the future is, so therefore you build for a short time. And the last one, which is a problem of modernity, is that a lot of people don't like it. that's it.
Okay. Johannes, I mean, I think you're going to probably have some very different views about these things. So we already talked about how it's okay for us to disagree sometimes. So.
But interestingly, maybe it's later this one. Yeah. I don't use slide.
Okay, that's right, I forgot.
But interestingly, what happened in Asia is quite contrary, because we like modernity and modernism. Take, for example, after the Second World War, there are many countries become independent. Countries like Indonesia, Malaysia, India start to embrace modernism and use modernism because it's so easy to be loaded by ideology and even the value of nationalism. So take, for example, like Nehru, and he engaged Le Corbusier to design Chandigarh. And Corbusier designed Chandigarh, but Chandigarh is not purely modern because it's also based on the Indian mandala. So there's a caste system reflected in the structure of the city, even the orientations and so on. And what happened in Chandigarh actually is not like social construct, horizontal socialism and so on, but still it's very traditional way of doing things. So the Asian youth embrace the idea of modernity and they just use it whatever they like. Like Sukarno, for example, they use modernism to fight against colonialism and build several monuments. But the monuments is full of symbolism. Cambodia, for example, Sihanouk, engaged Van Molivan, a very modernist architect. But when they designed the stadium just looked like a traditional Cambodian architecture, some looked like Angkor temples. But you can see the hybridity of modernity. Maybe it's because of the paradox of, well, it's tabula rasa, it's functional, but because it's tabula rasa and functional, so you can write whatever you like on that white sheet of paper. So it's become very interesting because in Asia, I think we value the intangible more than the tangible. For us, the tangible may die, but can be reborn. So you look, for example, like the temples in traditional sense, like the temple in Ise Shrine in Japan. Every 20 years, they will demolish the original temple completely and rebuild the entire temple on the other side exactly the same. So we value traditions and the way of building things and the knowledge and the intangible, but not the material authenticity. And we always consider building as a craft, not an industrial product. Even if you have a building produced by machines, by industries, prefab components, we tend to add something in between. We try to mix things. We try to even, we don't like to see a bare concrete. You know? We just put paint, make it colorful. So the kind of things that we enjoy, you know, that we can create the building as, consider building not as a box, but as a frame. So I think it's very interesting way of how we treated modern architecture or even international style and make it cosmopolitan. Like, for example, like the streamlined building in Singapore, the old airport buildings, from outside it looks very streamlined, very modernist. But inside, you can spot some ornaments. And even the floor, for example, we innovate with rubber from Malaysia, and to create a patterns on the wall, on the floor. And the people who build it is a craftsman from India, from China. Mm-hmm. So they mix the so-called the vernacular architecture, the classical knowledge, whatever, and they produce something that is totally different. So you can see the facade of the shop houses. It's not the modern or classical European architecture, but it's a mix of everything. Mm-hmm. So that's why it's become timeless, but not because it's pure, but because it's a hybrid. Mm-hmm. So in Man, we have a first discussion in Macau, the first time. We said that, well, if we compare it with dogs, mongrels maybe is more beautiful and more resilient. Because mongrel can survive, you know, and can adapt to any situations.
Right.
But if we have a German dog, you have a very special food and very difficult to maintain and very expensive. So the idea of the sustainability is only embedded in the understanding of modernity.
Yeah.
So when Hubert-Jan was saying that, you know, the original is, one of the things you said was the original is usually the most important, and that in terms of conservation, I mean, in fact, if you take what you're just saying, the intangible issues and the use and the hybrid nature of it, you would have a very different view on
yes.
that particular point.
So it's
point.
More important to engage the community, the users, the people, and in just order to get the memory, and then treat it the physical form as the container.
Right. Yeah. So as the use
frame.
Might be more important than
yes.
the fabric, for instance.
Yes.
So in order to retain the use, you may change the physical fabric
yes.
quite significantly.
And it's not a sin.
Mm.
Mm-hmm. You've raised a lot of questions.
Catherine, what do you think?
Where do we fit in this? Well, I think we are really interested in the material fabric of buildings. You know, in just that I think that it, you know, it's only by looking at what is there in front of you, what exists, that you can understand and unpick a whole load of stories. I mean, the three of us went to the Eames house earlier on today, and just looking there at how that was physically put together and to the extent of you know, industrial products against craft skills, you know, starting to speculate about how much pre-planning of that design there was, how much spontaneity on site, how much, you know, both in the original plan and then looking on a broader picture as to how that affects changes that have happened to that building over time. I mean, I think I would sort of fairly fundamentally disagree with the sort of DOCOMOMO idea that that 20th century buildings are, or modern movement buildings are something fundamentally different. I think we would see the conservation of the buildings that we care about as being part of a continuum with the conservation of buildings of previous ages. And that what we're interested in is thinking about how one would define the significance of each individual building that one comes to, and that will be the result of all sorts of different influences. You know, in some mm-hmm. buildings, the physical fabric, the technological innovation will be most important, and other times it'll be the political circumstances, you know, that there will be other things that one wants to preserve. Mm. I mean, and I think in the UK, one of the biggest problems that we face at the moment with the conservation, particularly of post-war architecture, is that these buildings are seen as, you know, the architecture of the post-war socialist governments. They are it's the physical embodiment of the welfare state. Mm. And, you know, that we've turned our backs on that, and politically that's deeply out of fashion.
Mm. Can I add something? Sure. Just a bit, because you mentioned about Eames House. The Eames House is a very interesting case because it has two elements, the left side and the right side. The left side is meticulously preserved as pristine as possible. Mm. Well, the other side is used by the foundations. So it's become more natural. You know? So it's like one body, because we talk about the architectural as a holistic entity. Mm-hmm. But you have the left side is being Botox, and the right side is aging naturally. So you can see the different treatment between the kitchen set on the left and the right. So it's become a very interesting case for the future, actually, to compare.
Yeah.
It's a PhD material, as I said. Right? To see how these two approaches come together in one single house. And now it starts from the zero because you preserve it, at the same time use the same materials, but then it's used differently. So I think you have a very interesting case
here.
Yeah, interesting. But that is a different type of hybrid. I mean, your hybrid, what you were talking about, the intangible and the tangible, you know, that makes sense. Yeah. Our way of looking at things in the West has been indeed much more towards the material. That's why we started conservation, all this sort of thing. Mm. And you were more on the intangible. I think why I'm very happy that we are now moving DOCOMOMO to Seoul, to Asia, is because we can learn from you and you can learn from us. The reason why, so that's one thing. The second thing is, you see, the reason why we look at it in a totally different way from you is because in Europe, when the modern movement started, there was a total idea of tabula rasa. The intention of the artists and the architects was to completely start from scratch, to forget about all traditions, to forget about all the all the constraints from the past, because you see, what happened was that the bourgeois tried to keep in the 19th century society at a certain level, and for the middle classes to continue in the way they were, to protect their own thing, and the working classes were left behind. So that was why there was a very political movement related to the modern movement, because people wanted to change that and give everybody their independence rather than only a few classes. So, and the idea of tabula rasa was to start from scratch, forget about history, and just look towards the future. And whether you like it or not, but they produce some fantastic icons. And that's why when we are faced with these icons, we don't want to approach it in a very hybrid way and say, you know, let's keep it or let's leave all the historic layers, but go back to the original intention, because that's where the beauty is and that's where the value of these things is. In other buildings where, and we come to that later, which are not iconically so important, obviously, you try to keep all the layers and you can do much more towards what the future users want. But with these particular icons, you don't want to do that. It's like Elder van Eyck once said to me, and he's at least for me a great Dutch architect, he once said to me, if you restore a Mondrian, you don't just simply say, ah, it's easier for the user to increase the thickness of the line by a millimeter, because you end up with a picture or painting and not a Mondrian any longer. And that is what it is. So with the real good stuff, I mean, you as conservation people, you're not going to, if it's a real important thing, you stick to the original thing, which is the most important thing. If it's not all that important as far as building is concerned, I totally agree. Let the user come and let we change the buildings in such a way that you still recognize what was originally there, but also add to the building quantity of what we use today. So it depends on what you're talking about. I mean, yeah. You don't go to the Forbidden City and just say, oh, let's change it.
Well, but Forbidden City has been changed over time.
Well,
and
yes,
the notion
but
of
not the concept.
Architecture, actually, in Asia, is not architecton, but it's more like in Sanskrit, it's called vastu. And vastu in Sanskrit means, if we freely translate that into English, it's become architecturing. It's a verb, not a noun. Mm-hmm. So that's why we see things as a soft things, not hard. Mm. So it's for us, it's very difficult to understand why we should cling into the material, the stone, the glass, the steel. It's temporary.
Yeah, sure, of course it is.
It's just skeleton. Yeah. Huh? But the soul of the buildings and the people who inhabited it, it's become more important because they give a soul. They give a life into that building. So it's become, the buildings become breathing. Mm-hmm. It's not artifacts.
Well, but then you must agree with me that conservation and at least modernity is a paradox.
Yes.
It's a total paradox.
But would you, Johannes, would you apply that approach to a building through any period through time? Or do you, I mean, are you talking specifically about conserving a modern heritage in this way? Or is this something, is this the way you would talk about conservation for
it's
a building
everything.
Of any period?
It's everything, right. Including the factory buildings, including the shop houses. Because for
but
us,
at earlier periods of work as well?
Yes. Yeah.
But then you need to, I mean, presumably at some point you are drawing, making a balance between making the, sort of facilitating those sorts of social uses and actually saying this is important historic fabric and we want to keep it. I mean, you know, do you think you're drawing a different balance with your 20th century buildings than your earlier buildings?
Well, we view history differently because you feel like everything happened at the same time. It's not linear. It's not started by industrial revolutions and then followed by modernization and so on. But colonizations, decolonizations, nationalism, industrializations happen at the same time. So you see everything is always intermingled and entangled.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So we see everything is like in the building is not just a product of a certain period. It's very difficult to classify buildings in periods in or styles.
But doesn't the building represent a particular period because it represents a way of
yes,
thinking
yes, kind of spirit
time.
Of age.
Yeah. Mm. Mm-hmm. But still, I make a difference between restoration and renovation, adaptive reuse. And as soon as cultural things come in, we start talking about restoration. As long as functional, technical, social things come in, you talk about renovation when you're reusing buildings. But there is a distinction. I mean, I think it's too easy to say, everything changes. Yes, everything changes. Yet you want to keep something. You do that as well.
But not entirely. So we can change the spare parts. So if one part is rotten, it's fine to replace that part.
That's what we do.
Right?
That's what we do.
So we don't try to preserve only the material integrity.
Okay. Yeah. But that's, now if you change the requirements, if you change, for example, you know, for ecological reasons, we have to change buildings because of our laws. Functional things, people want bigger spaces today than they wanted 50 years ago, etc., etc. Insulation requirements, etc. What do you do?
Just do it.
Yes. And now we come to a very important architectural icon. What do you do?
Well, it's a temporary one. So, for example, when they demolished the building in Seoul, the community, architecture community in Seoul and in Asia split into two camps. One, with this, we call it a very Eurocentric camp, with a member of DOCOMOMO Korea, you know, try, you know, to preserve because it's, well, but another group, we say it's fine because it's dealing with a very painful part of the history of Korea. Mm. You see, the cruelty of the Japanese is unbearable and unbelievable. So it's not like preserving, like the concentration camp, like Auschwitz, for example, as a lesson to history. Our attitude to history is different. We try to forget, not to forget the atrocities and so on, but the object that make us very painful. So we want to be healthy again. We want to forget because we want to be cured.
That makes sense. But a building that makes you happy.
And colonial buildings, like railroad, botanical gardens, all carry all this memory of the past of oppression and exploitation.
Okay.
Industrial buildings. It's not just about technology, but also about cruelties and the death of the traditions. So that is maybe the
I might move on to the next two questions on. because we're running out of time, so I'm going to flick through the slides when we get to them. But and maybe we could talk a little bit more about thinking about what some of the outstanding challenges are that your organisations are facing right now. Like, are there some emerging issues? Because 1979, the 20th Century Society was established. 89, DOCOMOMO, Man more recently. So over 20, 30 years of discussion and practice, publications about some of these issues. And there have been a number of successes and things have moved on. But I'm interested to hear from you whether you think there still are a number of challenges, what they might be, whether they're specific to your part of the world, what sort of things you're doing to address them. Perhaps, Catherine, would you... I'm going to flick through all of these slides. I almost lost the PowerPoint.
Shall I try and do it without the slides?
Lost the whole system, not just the PowerPoint. Maybe I got too happy with that button. I have to wait. Okay, I'm just going to leave this here and you can come and hand it to me. Can you do it? We might just keep going anyway. So, Catherine, can you talk about that from the perspective of the UK and 20th Century Society?
There are all sorts of different issues, and we're at a really interesting time across lots of different factors of what we're doing. I mean, I think we're just beginning to look at postmodern architecture, and that raises all sorts of really interesting issues. Are also, I think, very much involved. I think we've kind of won the debate that that preservation and conservation of 20th century buildings can be a real catalyst for urban regeneration. Mm-hmm. And also a great spur for tourism. But I think that we are, I think, what was I going to say about that? I've lost my train of thought now with your slides. I think there is a real issue for us about the role that conservation plays in gentrification, and that's particularly relevant to conservation of 20th century buildings. There's a huge kind of feeling that a lot of the particularly post-war housing estates, that if they were sold off on the open market and ceased to be public housing, they would, you know, that the physical problems could actually be addressed.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. It's coming back.
Yeah, it's coming back. Thank you. Oh, I've got to flick fast now and not turn it off again.
Do you want to stop there?
There? Yeah,
no, that one there with the elephant.
Oh, elephant.
Elephant's good. Yes. Yeah. So I mean how can we actually get involved in that debate about how conservation could be seen as something that actually is continuing to have a kind of meaningful role within that question of how communities change over time, you know, whether by going in as preservationists we are actually altering a social dynamic and maybe totally undermining some of the main objectives of the buildings that we're out to preserve. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of really interesting. Lots of issues still around materials, particularly concrete repair, which is my passion, that we still don't really have the answers to. Lots of stuff still, I think, about public perception. Maybe for us, brutalism. You know, for the general public, I think the name itself is still a barrier. I put this slide up because I think, I mean, this is Trellick Tower by Goldfinger in London, and for a long time we've had the sort of iconic tower block of this estate has been listed, and just last week some of the low-rise housing, which very much forms part of the overall estate, has been listed as well. And I think it's sort of moving on to that that next stage of taking a broader view of the historic environment of the 20th century and valuing some of the more background stuff as well as the really standout monuments.
Thank you. Hubert-Jan.
Yeah, I think the biggest challenge we are facing, here you are, is just the ecological situation that we consume four times of our footprint. So therefore, we have to change the idea of the market economy, therefore of modern architecture. Because if the constant new intemporality was the leading idea in what we have been doing, that has to change. So, and that not only has to change as far as new architecture is concerned, but also towards the fact that we just have to reuse buildings. You just have to reuse what you've got. And you know, this way of thinking, where buildings are only 20 years old and you just blow them up, is a ridiculous situation. But then, that I think that is the challenge. Now, with reuse of buildings, Catherine said it already, and I agree with that, if you start reusing the buildings, they were designed for different situation than we are in now. So that is the big challenge. What do you keep from the original in such a way that it fits into new ecological requirements, new social requirements, etc., yet you keep the as much as possible from the original or whatever happened afterwards. That is complicated. As far as our own organization is concerned, I said that already, we have a big challenge as well. We are growing so big that the original intentions are slowly moving away.
Which of those intentions?
To try to be a group of people who think in the same way and try to communicate ideas and debate. And debate within a large organization is very difficult. Debate in a small group is you get more concentrated, so therefore that works. Up to now, we seem to solve it, but as soon as we move into Asia, the scale will be totally different. We won't have a conference of 250, 300 people any longer, but of 700 or 1,000 people, which is a totally different way of working together. Our specialist committees will become, the complexity of modernity is so big, and we discussed that, there are so many different ideas of modernity, that how to keep that together, I don't know. In the beginning, we were very Eurocentric, then we moved to South America and to the United States, but we consider that as very European oriented. Then to South America, then the mentality started to change already into Africa, then into Asia, and then obviously it gets so complex that everything is possible. And I wonder what will happen.
To add into that complexity is the growth, the economic growth in Asia recently is very, very scary.
Yep.
I mean, it's like China, Southeast Asia, even India. We don't need the illustrations.
Okay.
So fine. That is creating another problems of real estate growth.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of developers doing some M blocks and demolishing building and build a more expensive condominium from the newly rich Chinese or Indians or Arabs who come to the regions. And that's posed a real problems to the say, heritage, which is older than say, maybe 20 or younger than 20 years old, or even 50 years old, it's all gone. And the second, of course, is the economic greed. It cannot stop, it just consumes. And one of the biggest challenges now, especially in the heritage cities, World Heritage Area, is mass tourism. Because they forgot that actually the World Heritage status is a responsibility, not endorsement or award from UNESCO. But the government's thought is an endorsement to their success in selling the city to tourists. And it's fueled by the proliferations of budget flights. So now everybody can fly to any cities in the regions. So the growth of airlines, even Indonesia, for example, purchased maybe 700 new Boeings from to for the budget airlines alone, not to mention China and India and so on. So this posed a real problem to our historical fabric. And of course, the so-called conservation become more and more difficult because, well, why money is more important? Why we should preserve some things that is hampered with growth and developments? And not to mention the conference with 1,000 people attending, 700,000 people with 1,000 different ideas.
Yeah.
And they have money.
Yeah.
But I think we can still see hopes, yeah, because not everything is, you know, I think everything is like a cyclical movement.
Mm-hmm.
If everything goes to the extreme left, then the pendulum will swing back to the right. I think it's in the human nature that we really try to balance all these things. So the most interesting part in Asia right now is the developments of the grassroots movement and the NGOs,
mm-hmm.
and getting stronger and stronger. And then mm-hmm. the social media platform, internet, mm-hmm. become a powerful weapon
right.
to change things. It's not just to create spring everywhere or to occupy whatever they can occupy.
Mm.
But it's being used more positively by these people, by these young generations, mm-hmm. to organize themselves,
mm-hmm.
to change the situations. And one example of what we did was in Bhopal, India, on the sites of the Union Carbide disaster.
Mm-hmm.
Some group of young architects, a member of MAN, supported by lawyers, by local industries and corporate and press, who feel that justice has to be, you know, straightened, and that the victims is being forgotten have to be somehow recognized.
Mm-hmm.
So they organized a small workshops, international workshop students, and just to propose interpretive center to remind people about Bhopal before they embrace modernity and industry. That Bhopal used to be a very rich agricultural land with a lot of craftsmanships and so on. And the old, good old days. And when they submitted all this to embrace a new faith, the fertilizer and the industry, and that is the end of everything. And then now they are being betrayed by industry. So the kind of feelings, you try to address it more positively by not, okay, suing the government or suing the company is a different matter, but at least to restore pride to their own heritage.
Mm-hmm.
So that kind of movements happening in different town and different city, and there's some dialogue using tweets or blogs mm-hmm. and so on the ground that it's become kind of positive signs.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because mm-hmm. the excessive consumerism actually somehow is also creating some emptiness.
Mm-hmm.
And this emptiness among these younger generations is being fulfilled, not just by, well, gaming. They're getting bored with game anyway. Now they start to use internet more seriously.
Right. Mm.
Right. After several success mm-hmm. in the Middle East, even, well, Obama, or mm. even the LDP government in Japan.
Mm.
It's thanks to internet. And the Indonesia, for example, is the biggest user of BlackBerry. So mm. all the bandwidth of gone, you know, the internet was very, very slow, but everybody has a BlackBerry.
Right.
And because Barack Obama is from Jakarta, so it's a BlackBerry has become very popular in Indonesia.
Okay, well, it's 8:10, and perhaps we might open the discussion to the floor at this moment. I think we have some microphones that are around. So if you would like to make a comment or ask a question, there's one down the front just here.
Michael Webb, I'm an architectural writer. It seems to me that in Europe anyway, there has now developed a real constituency for modern architecture. Perhaps you don't see it quite in that way, but I remember in the 60s when I was writing a book on New Brutalism, this was regarded as something between the Black Death and an invasion from Mars. I mean, something that was so horrible to contemplate that if people had it in their power to go and tear these buildings down physically, they would have. And now, you know, they've become objects for preservation. Do you feel that through your efforts and others, working in the same cause, that indeed in Britain, in Europe, and in Asia, I understand it's a different situation, that there is really now a broader awareness of the quality of modernism, of the value of modernism, and the fact that, it, as you said, it's part of a continuum. It's not an isolated phenomenon, but rather a multi-headed set of variations on traditional architectural themes going back centuries. Here, I don't believe that's happened. I think in America, it's still very much a struggle, and one keeps encountering grotesque examples of Philistinism, the complete neglect of the modern heritage, and often its destruction.
Mm. I don't think it's totally sunny where we are. I think that there's probably a groundswell of increased enthusiasm and understanding for the, particularly for the brutalist buildings. The reason we nominated British Brutalism to the World Monument Fund was that although we'd recommended listing of all those buildings, and they'd actually been, that had been endorsed and really strongly backed by English Heritage, who were the government's official advisors, the minister, who is a politician, who gets to make the final decision, had overridden those recommendations in the case of most of the major brutalist buildings of the 60s and 70s, which seemed to me to be outrageous that one individual could just, you know, basically make that decision. So I think they're probably, yeah, I think there's an enormous growing energy. I think there's a lot of people who come and join the 20th Century Society, I think, find us through a passion for photography, and that a lot of these buildings are incredibly photogenic. They see them as something that inspires their photography, and then they want to know more about the history. So we're seeing that a lot.
And in Asia, we witness the growth of the knowledge productions, especially the books written about architecture and modern from local, national, and regionals, are proliferating everywhere. And the most encouraging part is that some of this book is written in English or translated from English. And some people are trying to dig into the old archives and old texts and translate from Japanese to English, from Turkish to English, from Indonesians to English. So it's growing, you know? And we are trying to move into, for example, is trying to ride into these waves by providing a platform. So the next, I think, plan is actually is to use the e-book kind of things. That people can have a translation, share it for free on the internet. Because you say that knowledge is free, it's not supposed to be, you know, copyright or whatever. Copyright is important, but for academics, let's forget about it. Now the speed of sharing is more important. But the main problem, of course, is the conservative academics. They still stick to the old way of, you know, assessing things. For example, for your tenure, if you don't have a, you know, your articles published in the impact factor is very low. But we don't know that actually the impact factor is controlled by a cartel of publishers. It's not really like Google Scholars. So maybe Google Scholars is more appropriate, you know, for indexing and so on. So there's still a struggle in the academic world, but the most encouraging sign is the, in my opinion, is the proliferations of the creations of maps, like the green maps, like heritage maps of different cities based on the comprehensive inventory. And soon, I think, in the next 5 or maybe shorter than that, there will be a lot of information available on the net. And that could be a very good sign of this a new discourse in interest in the knowledge productions about modernism and modernity in Asia.
I think also time has to do with it. People hate change, whereas the idea of the market economy of our societies is change. And therefore, every time there is a new type of architecture, people try to avoid it. But after 10, 50, let's say, after such a period, the first thing you do is reject it. And then after 20 years or 25 years, slowly people begin to appreciate it because you look at it in a different way. So that helps as well.
It's also cycles of maintenance and repair, isn't it? I mean, just to be totally kind of pragmatic about it, I think the first, you know, buildings 20 to 30 years after their construction are in need of their sort of first makeover. Mm. And, you know, we're kind of struggling to address that. And, and once we've got beyond that, then people reevaluate them.
Yes, and that's true. I mean, older buildings, you would have a longer passage of time before you really had to deal with major restoration. So, but we've got appreciation and the need for repair happening at the same moment, which is different from previous periods. But I think my own observation would be that the countries that have always had really good legislation and community support for heritage and it's embedded in society generally have come quicker to dealing with their modern heritage. You know, I think in the UK it's a country and many parts of Europe too that have always had a deep appreciation, well, good protection, heritage agencies, money, you know, all these sort of things. It's they've come quicker to the party. I think in a lot of parts of the world this issue of the need for advocacy, the need for awareness raising, advocacy and pushing government, bringing governments who are responsible for protection to the party is still really important, and we certainly have seen that in our ICOMOS 20th Century Committee as being a big need still in a lot of parts of the world. When we write down what are the things that we still kind of need, awareness raising, appreciation and advocacy are still very much kind of part of that need.
Hi, I had more of a question in regards to the architecture, like Asian architecture, when you talked about the hybridness of cultures in regards to like ornaments or and such. And I was wondering, how do you avoid it becoming shallow or kitschy, like putting these ornaments together that become very concentrated on aesthetic? How do you preserve that heritage to translate to people who are just coming in and not just being attracted and knowing that a dragon is a symbol of power as opposed to just a very awesome mythical creature?
Well, it's a bit difficult to answer this kind of question, but okay, let me try. We did a lot of comprehensive inventory of so-called the modern heritage in different cities in Asia, and we used the so-called the butterfly methods of judging the quality of a building. You know, human brain has a left and right sides. One is emotional, the other one is rational. The emotional part is the aesthetics, the memory, the happiness, and so on, the laugh. You know? And the right side is the more rational, like the value of history, and the materials, and the design, and so on. So we use this both method to judge the quality of buildings. And it's not based on the expert judgment, but also how the community see that objects. So when we put a buildings into a form, for example, we tend to not to select the building, but to put every building as possible into the registry. So for example, typically in Jakarta, we did a comprehensive inventory in 2 weeks involving about 60 students, in multinational students, and they have to virtually walk every street and every corners and to ask the local community to discuss about the values or the significance of the buildings. And then we put it on a chart, like the butterfly, with four axes, and you put these circles. So if the circle is big, then left and right balance, then is high on the list. If it's small or imbalanced, so we put it in the reserve list. So we managed to record about 6,000 buildings, which is said to be significant by both, by the expert students and the communities. And out of that 6,000, we select about 200 or 300, which is put in the map. So we produce a big heritage map of all these buildings from all the criteria, which is based on this methodology. So whether it's kitschy or not kitschy, we don't know.
But isn't the danger when you do that, I think it's a beautiful method, but the danger is exactly what I was trying to say earlier on, time. because, you know, if you ask the public at large, what do you think about that building? They might say, I think it's very ugly. Whereas yes. in 20 years' time, they might say, well, you know, it's, I understand what it is. It takes time. And the professionals, I'm not trying to say that it's only the professionals who should decide, but the professionals at least are trained to take some distance. So how do you solve that problem?
That's why the selections process from 6,000 to 300 will involve a more rigorous kind of okay. evaluations.
Okay.
Which is involving more high levels of, yeah. of scholars and, okay. and debates. And they're not just scholars, but also activists and yeah. industrialists, corporate, and even governments. Mm-hmm. So we bring these discussions from the bottom up. So we try to build up the inventory, not top down, mm-hmm. only from expert, but mm. trying to inverse and make it more democratic. So of course, among that 600, maybe there is some prime heritage. For example, the so, most important buildings.
So how, what would you say was the basic question you were framing to people? You know, is this a good building? Is this building mean, does this yeah. building mean something to you?
Yeah.
What's the sort of bottom line?
We develop a set of criteria.
Yeah.
The cultural criteria mm-hmm. and the architectural criteria.
Mm. So social significance, historic.
Yes.
Mm. So, uh-huh.
Yeah. And in the cultural, you have the political mm-hmm. significance, social, mm-hmm. economic history, memory, and so on. Mm-hmm. Well, now, the other side is more technical.
And what then the next question is, what is the definition of significance? We introduce the idea of innovation. With the modern movement, you can do that because that's the basis of the whole thing. So if it wasn't innovative, we would say, okay, it's out. It's debatable, but then
that
Sharp
is the
came up with the idea.
Rational side.
Yeah.
But the emotional side?
No. It's innovation in social, yeah. in a social context, in a technological context, or in an aesthetic context.
How about the emotional part? Well, for example, like, well, this building used to be a murder
fits
site.
Into the
and it used to be a place where some of the Chinese was murdered mm-hmm. by the riots. Okay, or when the Japanese torture some of the, you know, independent, not everyone, you know, being shot.
Mm. Well, that's, but isn't the difference kind of for what you're talking about? I mean, you're coming from DOCOMOMO's point of view, which is interested in architecture. And I think what you're talking about is heritage, and a lot of the places that you're identifying aren't necessarily of architectural significance, they are of heritage
yes.
value.
Yes. Yeah.
And so it's just that, if you like, DOCOMOMO's interest is a subset of the heritage values that might normally be used to yeah. assess the yeah. significance of yeah. a place. So I think we're talking about almost it's like a subset of these things.
It might well be, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I think we would say that we are interested in buildings, and we see that as just part of a broader cultural history of
yeah.
the world.
Yeah, and of society.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
Because it's society which produces these buildings, so and our switch as well.
So I think academics play a very important role here as the keeper of all this
yes.
discourse.
Yes. Yes.
So I remember Jeff, we are mm-hmm. in Chiang Mai about 5 years ago, and we are trying to develop a kind of curriculum and to push the conservations into disciplines, mm-hmm. just like archaeology, you know. Yes. But I don't know how far this movement is going on, but it's extremely important to make this kind of discourse was put in the university levels of debates mm-hmm. Among academics to bridge the all the stakeholders, basically, mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. to balance the so-called the rational approach and the irrational, the emotional and the aesthetics and so on. Mm-hmm. And that is be put nicely into a curriculums that can be adopted by universities to make this a more serious discussions on heritage and conservations.
But may I ask you a question? Isn't it tremendously difficult in Asia to get people interested in conservation, because you are very much geared to the new. You said that yourself. We demolish and we constantly rebuild. So how do you get people interested in keeping the materiality?
Well, it's become a fashion now.
Okay.
Especially in Shanghai, Beijing, for example, because it's become a lifestyle. And it's begun from, started from Shanghai when one of our members actually restored, used a factory as it is, mm-hmm. and as an architecture office. It's a Teng Kun Yan. And then that building won the UNESCO Asia Pacific Award. And then he embraced a new project in Huangpu River, a former General Electric factory, and turned it into a cultural hub. Mm-hmm. And it's highly publicized by the people, even the magazines, like in-flight magazines. It's become a very popular spot for pre-wedding shots, photos. And also for the MTV, for the Kanto pop, Chinese pop, Japanese pop, whatever. You know? And it's followed by the former factory building in Shanghai and Beijing and so on. And also, of course, something like Xintiandi, like Singapore River. The shop house suddenly become a high-valued kind of objects because it's cool.
Yeah, it's mm-hmm. it's interesting you're saying that because we, about 10 years ago, I think, the DOCOMOMO Japan used a completely different approach towards getting people interested in modern buildings and the heritage of modern buildings as compared to us. They went to a magazine, a sort of Japanese Vogue.
Yes.
And they were on the front cover, DOCOMOMO, and they even used the word DOCOMOMO as as a word for 20th century heritage. And you saw all these models, in front of these Japanese icons, etc. It was amazing. You know, they went through a complete different approach than we did. Fantastic. Yeah. It became fashion.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm going to draw us to a close now.
Yeah.
So we don't have any other questions, and we are out of time as well. So before I thank our panelists, I just wanted to draw attention to our next lecture that's happening on Thursday, the 17th of January. Is that the right date? Thank you, Kyle. And that will be a discussion about, or a lecture actually, about the Louis Kahn's Yale Centre for British Art that is, and we're going to be joined by Peter Inskip and Stephen G from Peter Inskip and Jenkins Architects from London, who are working with Constance Clement, who is the Deputy Director of the Yale Centre for British Art. And they're going to talk about the approach to dealing with this building over the last few years that they've been working on it. So please register, come along. We'd love to see you in the new year. At the next of those lectures. I'd like to thank our panellists, Catherine, Johannes and Hubert-Jan for joining us. They all flew great distances and only got here last night, two of them, and have managed to last all day and through this evening. But thank you very much for being here and for this evening's discussion. And thank you also to Kyle and Anna and Carol and Jeff who've helped to organise this evening. Thank you very much.